So thank you for coming out tonight to hang with me and support my book, which hopefully everybody bought. I'm gonna read a little bit from this book, and then Aaron and I are gonna chat a little bit, and then you can ask me questions if you wanna ask me questions, which I really hope you will. That's it, right?
It's perfect, yeah.
That's it.
Word perfect.
I've never done this before. So bear with me if it's a mess. Cool. How many people have read the book already? I feel like a few. Yeah. Great. Great. Thank you for doing so. And for buying it anyway. So I'm going to read from the beginning of the book. And I don't actually think there's anything you really need to know, because it's the beginning of the book. Still getting the hang of this. Yeah, I'm just gonna start, if that's cool, with you guys. Here we go. This is crazy. I can't believe this.
Just be thankful you got to be here to tell your story, because that's...
Seriously. Whoa, you guys. Whoa. If you've read the book, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, cool. Gilded Razor. I was 17 years old and had been subsisting on a diet of cigarettes and Adderall for months. Now, on a sunny fall morning, I was on my way to visit Princeton. My father was waiting downstairs on 88th Street off West End Avenue in front of our apartment building. He had rented a nondescript blue sedan, no frills, with upholstery that smelled faintly medicinal, talk radio pontificating from the tinny speakers, and now stood with one hand on the hood of his car, making small talk with the doorman. On his hand, his wedding ring was conspicuously absent. As I watched him, I convinced myself that I could see a trace of a tan line on his ring finger, a thin band of flesh paler than the natural olive of his skin. But then I blinked, and it was only a trick of the light. I shook my head. It was a stupid, sentimental thought. I usually tried not to think about my parents' divorce. Its once prominent space in my consciousness had descended into the shadows of everyday normalcy, and now sometimes it seemed as if they had never been together at all. In the same way that I watched people milling about in Midtown Manhattan, so inoculated to the city's mammoth scale that they no longer realized how strange and spectacular a sight it was, the skyscrapers, the crowds, concrete and steel, the emptiness left by my parents' separation was so enormous that I had forgotten how it once felt extraordinary. And when I was in Midtown, I, too, looked straight up ahead like a native New Yorker. Only a tourist would look up. Only someone embarrassing would still be haunted by the collapse of his parents' marriage a full year after it had happened. I stood on the sidewalk for a moment, nursing a sickly sweet cup of bodega coffee and sucking down my first cigarette of the morning. In a paper bag at my feet was a lemon poppy seed muffin, glazed with a sugary sheen, which I had bought not to eat, but to prove to myself that I could keep from eating. I wasn't about to ruin my diet by eating solid food now, especially on the day I was to visit Princeton, which I had recently decided was probably my dream school. I was dressed in preppy staples, a V-neck sweater and a warm autumnal scarlet, the ivory collar of a dress shirt starched and collegiate around my throat, a reptile knotted in a loose foreign hand. My father wore a long-sleeved thermal shirt and jeans, the self-effacing functionality of which annoyed me. Whenever he came home from work, I'm glad somebody laughed. Whenever he came home from work, he always seemed eager to shed the markers of his professional life, the cufflinks, the wool slacks, and change into something comfortable and utilitarian. I preferred to keep my tie on until I went to bed, not wanting to lose the power I pretended it gave me, aligning me with the pedigreed prep school boys whose cravats were always effortlessly askew. There were even nights when I slept in my blue blazer, a security blanket, I told myself, to remind me who I was supposed to be. Mostly, though, I did this so I could tell people I'd done it. I hoped it would make me seem more interesting somehow. Earlier that summer, my father had told me he would take me on a trip to visit the colleges that interested me, but I'd been wary. My prospects for college were dim. I was already certain that no school that met my impossibly high standards would accept me as a student, and no school that accepted me as a student could possibly be worth attending. Princeton, a bastion of privilege, even the name sounded rich in my mouth, Princeton, seemed like the institution most beyond my reach, which was exactly what made it so attractive. But the actual process of applying felt so tedious. I preferred to spend my time in self-aggrandizing fantasy, or its darker counterpart, neurotic dread. That was so much easier than actually doing anything. Most of all, the whole thing seemed implausible. Would my father really make the time to chauffeur me up and down the Northeast Corridor to check out colleges that he and I both knew were too good for me? His travel schedule for business was unrelenting, and even when he was in the city, he often stayed at the Upper East Side apartment of his girlfriend, Jennifer. So now that we were finally leaving on this road trip, any flickering enthusiasm I might have felt for this next chapter of my life was smothered by what I perceived as the emptiness of my father's gesture. Surely this college tour had nothing to do with where I would actually end up going to school. It was about maintaining the lie that I was a happy and successful teenager with a bright future before me. I had to keep going through the motions because if I didn't, my father might start to pay closer attention to me. That was the last thing I needed. Yet even though I hustled my father constantly, lying and manipulating him to keep him at arm's length, I was devastated by the fact that he couldn't see through it. I wanted him to know me deeply enough to recognize that I was struggling. Not that I would have admitted it at the time. My mood grew foul as I lingered on the sidewalk, smoking the cigarette down to the filter. My father called my name and I extinguished the butt with the toe of my loafer, then stalked over to the car. As usual, he hadn't realized that I was upset, but then I hadn't realized I was upset yet either, let alone why, and I was unwilling to tell him. Instead, and also as usual, I was determined to punish him for not understanding this thing that even I didn't understand by being as sullen as possible. I slid into the passenger seat. The mood in the car felt heavy. To most 17-year-olds, I imagine, college represented liberation, a period of endless possibility. But for me, the idea of being shackled to academia for another 4 years was exhausting. I was what I like to call myself a lazy overachiever or a failed perfectionist, a deadly combination of ambition and sloth. College would just be the next place where I would strive and fail in the pursuit of excellence and subsequently loathe myself for it. As I sat in the passenger seat and considered this line of thought, I couldn't help but feel a thrill of smug superiority. To already be so bitter as I toured one of the nation's most prestigious colleges felt like the mark of how very adult I had become. Certainly it elevated me above the ranks of naively optimistic high school seniors who were genuinely excited about college. Those kids weren't as sophisticated as I was. It took years for me to learn that there was a difference between cynicism and maturity. In the car that day, they seemed to be one. My father looked over at me with a sort of friendly disdain. "You know that everything you know smells like smoke, right?" he said. "I know, Dad," I said. "Just checking." As he turned the key in the ignition, I took out my iPod and put on my father's noise-canceling headphones. We cruised onto the highway. I rolled down my window and let my arm drape lazily on the frame of the car door, feeling the chill of the wind directing the downy hairs on my arm. It was still early in the morning, and daybreak was crisp and clear. The trees on Riverside Drive were beginning to turn. Autumn was a welcome respite from the steaming heat of the New York summer, my first full New York summer, the brutality of which had astonished me. The city festered and stank, hot mist rising in a scalding cloud from the subway grates where, below, I could hear the shrill whistle of trains piercing the muggy night. Even my cigarettes had wilted. My father hated the summer heat as much as I did, although we had both spent much of the season away. I went to Oregon to see my now single mother while he took frequent business trips punctuated by weekends away with Jennifer. On the rare occasion that we were both in the city at the same time, we sprawled across the living room couch, saturated with perspiration, panting like wounded animals while the air conditioner clicked and whirred, straining against the sauna that was the city. Strangely, I loved those sweaty moments with my father, those instances of shared suffering, though I lacked the emotional intelligence to ever tell him so. On some level, I must have recognized the significance of those times because I locked them away in my mind as evidence that there was a bond between us more meaningful than blood. I could see it, but I couldn't quite access it. I couldn't translate it into actual affection. On those days, which I could have spent lolling around in the heat, my father would quickly grow restless, needing to busy himself with shuffling paperwork at his desk or leaving to take a jog through Central Park. He always seemed most comfortable in motion. Like me, he had been chubby as a child, and he exercised religiously. Now, behind the wheel, he was cool and controlled even as the chaos of rush hour exploded on the street outside. Back in Oregon, my mother would speed and brake breathlessly, muttering expletives under her breath, and on one memorable occasion, careening the wrong way up a one-way street, past a well-marked do not enter sign. I missed that recklessness, especially here, gliding so smoothly through the city with my father. We approached the mouth of the Lincoln Tunnel, the lanes clotted with underslept commuters. With my headphones on, I could see my father's mouth working, but I pretended not to notice. He He tapped me on the shoulder and I took off the headphones. Symphonies of honking horns suddenly screamed around me, making my shoulders clench. What? I said, sighing loudly in a performance of agitation. I said, first stop Princeton, he said. I could tell how hard he was trying. I know, Dad, I said. I wanted to connect with him, but I put the headphones back on instead. I feel like that's enough, right? Thanks.
Well, I have to say I didn't know you too well before reading this book, although you've written for Out. In fact, a section of this book in another version appears in Out. And now I feel I know you almost too well.
Yes.
The hallmark of the Gilded Razor for me, and there are a lot of good addiction memoirs have been written in the last few years, but the hallmark of this for me, and I think you might have got some of it then, is an excruciating honesty, a self-scrutiny that is not at all sentimental, certainly not self-pitying. At times I felt you were talking of yourself almost in the third person, as if this was another you. I wonder how when you embark on a project like this where it really calls on you to be 100% transparent about yourself, how you find the courage to be that honest to all those people, your parents, your friends, and ultimately yourself.
Well, it's a great question, Aaron.
I'll throw you in at the deep end here.
Yeah, no, let's dive right in. I don't know that, I don't want to say that I didn't feel like I had a choice, because obviously I had a choice and I chose to be like really, really, really honest in this book. I mean, I think in retrospect, like if I could start this process over from the beginning, might have held a little bit back, you know? I mean, like I could have. I approached it with a slightly like black and white morality of like, I'm going to put everything in this book. And in retrospect, I'm not actually sure about that choice. We'll see how this goes. I do know that it was really important to me, I think, because I was so inspired by writers who were really, really honest in their own work, that I try and do the same. And I think, you know, when you're writing about the self, when you're writing personal narrative, it's so important that you don't hold shit back, because the most bracing things, the things that are most kind of ugly to take out and you know, like hold under the light, are the things that are most compelling and that people are most inclined to identify with, you know? Like, it's always the shit that you're most embarrassed by that when you say it out loud, somebody's like, yeah, same. I hope none of you say same after reading this book. But like, in general, I think that tends to be the case, that people have really strong feelings of self-identification with whatever is scariest and most vulnerable to expose. So it felt necessary in that way, I guess.
I think there are two, well, there are lots of types of readers. There are two broadly in my mind. And one of them is the sort of, you know, naive reader, which might be myself. Someone who in my own 20s and late teens had a kind of love affair with New York. It was kind of, you know, it was a city where I was gonna have the bright lights, big city experience that Jay McEnany wrote about. In fact, I once said to him, I came to New York because of your book. I want sex and I want drugs, and that's why I came here. And he was like, you poor thing. You totally didn't get it. It was a cautionary tale, not a romance. And yet at the same time, in this book, you're very good at signposting a few times through it that it's a narrative you kind of wanted to buy into yourself. I think at one point, I'm going to quote, you say, only if I stayed in crisis would my life retain its narrative viability. It's this idea that you kind of had to descend into that to experience the world fully and wholly. And for some of us, the naive ones like myself, that was kind of an idealism I had. Like, I want to go to the city to get fucked up, basically.
Right.
Am I totally wrong in ever feeling that way?
Because no. I think
you've gone through it and come through the other side.
Yeah, I think that's totally fine to feel that way. I hope many of you feel that way. I think, I don't know. Like, I was a teenager and I wanted to be interesting. Don't all teenagers? I think, like, I wanted to be cool and I wanted to be edgy and I wanted things to be dark. And, like, you know, that I conflated darkness and glamour, you know, in this sort of pursuit of the sorts of behavior that I get into in the book. You know, I don't think there's anything naive about that. I mean, I just, like, hightailed it for, you know, the craziest shit I could get into. And you know, I think that New York has that promise for everyone who comes here. You know, it's a place where there's a lot of light and there's a lot of dark, and that darkness is more sort of readily available than it is in other places where you have to seek it out a bit more. You know, for me, I was really, really attracted to, you know, the things that I could do here that I didn't feel like I could do other places.
Right. You know, one of the things that struck me as I was reading it, and actually sort of taps into something I've been thinking about today, because as we all know, David Bowie died last night, and I was spending a lot of time thinking about him, and of course, it's cheap to extrapolate from one life to another, but one of the things, quote that Bowie said, or something, one of the many things that he's talked about was wanting to be other than himself, and hence, going from Davy Jones to David Bowie to Aladdin Sane to Ziggy, like, all of these were really manifestations of him trying to find the person he wanted to be. And much of this book, when you're reading it, is really about, it's a coming of age story of someone wanting to be someone other than he is.
Yeah.
In your case, often a kind of very preppy kind of school kid who loves tuna tartare, but nevertheless, a projection of someone that you do not feel you are. And that move from Portland to New York kind of crystallizes that effort to be someone else, right?
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, I think that's, like, under most circumstances, like, a normal, healthy part of adolescence is, like, you sort of try on different identities and you experiment with different things to kind of figure out who you are and who you want to become as you, like, grow into adulthood. And, you know, I did that in much more colorful ways than I think a lot of people did. But the impulse was basically the same, I think. And I'm really pleased and heartened that you call it a coming of age story, which is what I thought I was writing a coming of age story. And the reception has been like, sex, drugs, like, oh my God. Which, like, I get, because obviously there's a lot of that in the book. But, you know, I hope sincerely that there is, you know, underneath the very specific circumstances, there's a kind of universality to that story, because, you know, we're all searching for an identity, I think, especially when we're young. And, you know, you can find that a lot of different ways. And, you know, for me, I think this book, I learned so much about myself while I was writing this book, and felt like in the process of doing so, you know, it did sort of crystallize my identity now as an adult even more by revisiting this process of trying to find my identity as a teenager.
One of the aspects that you don't skate over are the ways in which, you know, people, the system, let's say, facilitates you. There is a doctor in this book who prescribes an extraordinary amount of pharmaceutical drugs to you. I was kind of astonished.
Yeah.
And it seemed to me that that's the kind of thing you would get stricken off the register for doing. I mean, have you confronted him or any of the people in the story about the way they sort of participated in your...
No.
journey?
No, I haven't. I think, you know, it's worth saying that, you know, like, if I hadn't found a doctor who was willing to prescribe lots and lots of drugs, I probably would have found a doctor who wasn't and convinced him to prescribe lots and lots of drugs, because that's who I was as a teenager. And so, you know, I don't, I mean, he was definitely, like, a hack and a charlatan, but, like, you know, he, like, I don't know. I actually remember my dad writing him a letter after I overdosed on his drugs, on the drugs that the doctor had given me. Like, threatening legal action, but I don't think anything ever came of it. You know, I there are definitely people who were, like, complicit in, you know, this downslide that I had, but And maybe I'm like, you know, sort of hard on myself in a way that I shouldn't be, but like, I don't hold anybody responsible for it. You know, the culture of kids in a Manhattan prep school is like, you know, if it hadn't been that doctor's drugs, like it would have been a pad somebody stole from their dad who was a doctor, you know, like I don't necessarily think that that it was, I don't hold him or anybody else responsible, really. Maybe I should.
I was very relieved. There's a place in this book, I don't think it's giving anything away too much, called Aspen. And of course, you initially think you're going to go skiing in Aspen.
I was so excited. And
for anyone who's read the book, Aspen, or hasn't read the book, Aspen is actually a sort of boot camp rehab facility in Utah. And it's awful. Like, everything about it sounds awful. And I was expecting this sort of prototypical come to God moment when halfway through you're like, oh my God, I'm transformed. This is amazing. I'm going to be, a healthy person now. I'm going to leave here and everything's going to be great. And actually you leave saying, well, that was shit.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a lot of recidivist rates there. That recidivist rates are high. And, you know, there's that moment where you're expected to shout, I'm a buffalo standing on top of a mountain. And I just felt this so appeals to a kind of current that we're in America right now.
Yeah.
Of, you know, physical pain will redeem you. It's sort of the CrossFit mentality in some way. You know?
Yeah.
And you didn't buy into that.
No, I didn't buy into it fully. I bought into it a little bit. Like, you know, in retrospect, there were a lot of things about being in this wilderness program that, like, were actually kind of super fun, you know? Like, now that I'm, like, a professional adult, if I was, like, dropped in the woods for a couple months to just, like, kick it, I think that would be super cool. But at the time, as a very manicured New York teenager, it was not where I wanted to be at all. So, you know, that program has actually since been shut down because a couple kids died there.
When you read the book, you can see how
I'm smiling because, like, I was talking with somebody today. I don't want to, like, spoil anything, but there was a moment where, like, we're in the middle of nowhere in the woods, and there are just, like, bears, like, full-blown bears crossing our path. And I had this moment where I was like, I just gotta let this bear maul me. Like, I just gotta fucking let this bear, like, I just gotta run directly towards this bear and let it do its, like, full revenant just, like, all over me, because, like, I cannot be here anymore. So I'm laughing because, like, I was very nearly one of those kids who died if I had run towards that bear as I had the impulse to do, which I'm glad I didn't. Don't run towards bears when you are in the middle of the woods.
Of course, the flip side of all that is the one thing you realize, or one of the many things you realize or begin to appreciate, is that old kind of truism that you can't force an addict to go into rehab. They have to make that choice.
Yeah, I think that's true. I mean, I think, like, I benefited from being forced to go to rehab because I was not, like, out doing drugs. I was, like, in rehab, which I think was a good thing, because who knows what would have happened if I hadn't been, you know, there. I'm sort of, like, wary of the, like, of the school of thought that, like, people have to get, like, it has to get really, really, really sick for people to get better. Like, it's a cliche, but, like, you hit bottom when you stop digging. And I think that, you know, there's opportunity to not have things get super, super fucked up. But I definitely needed things to get, like, really, really, really bleak for me to recognize that it had to change, I think.
One thing that that I was, I wouldn't say puzzled by, but intrigued by, is you do not go through this book really looking too hard for an explanation for your behavior. You do talk about a relationship with an older man when you were 14, and the sort of sexual abuse that came out of that, rape, essentially. But you sort of drop it as well. You don't, like, pursue that too hard. It's almost as if you don't want to find explanations for your behavior.
I guess it's more that I think it's really slippery to assign too much kind of like causal responsibility on anything that happens and how it like produces something like, you know, a drug addict and the way that I was. Like, I think that, you know, there's a strong biological and genetic component to addiction and mental illness. And there's definitely an environmental component too. But, you know, for me, I knew the way I was, you know, like I knew how my brain worked. I knew what it felt like to be in my body and to be in my skin, which was, it was super, super uncomfortable all the time unless I was getting fucked up. And then it wasn't uncomfortable anymore. So I got fucked up all the time. And that sounds a little bit reductive, but I think, like, you know, if I had to explain what it is like to be an active addict to somebody, it's literally that. It's like you are crawling out of your skin all the time, and then there's medicine available. Obviously, you're going to take the medicine. You would have to be an idiot to continue staying in discomfort, and the medicine is drugs, and then it ruins your life. So, like, I guess interrogating why I felt that way in this book never felt like a super productive exercise for me, because it was as sort of natural and innate a part of my experience as, you know, anything else that I knew to be true about me, you know, like the color of my eyes or something. Like, it was part of who I was. That was how I felt. That was how I'd felt as long as I could remember. And so I think I didn't try and like get too deep into why I did the things I did, because that's why, because I was super uncomfortable all the time.
Right. I mean, the springboard for this in some ways is your parents' divorce as well.
Yeah.
And both your parents figure, as they should, in the memoir. Your father, I would say more ambivalently, like your way of summoning him in the book seems more ambivalent than, say, mm-hmm. your mother. I wonder how unresolved your relationship to him is, if I may ask.
Well, it's a work in progress, I think. My dad was really, really gracious and generous about this book. He read it. I think he was expecting it to be worse. He had no objections. That was awesome. I was really, really stressed out about him reading it, and it was totally fine. He effectively gave me his blessing. So I think, you know, in writing about him, you know, what I'm really writing about, I think, is a sort of absence. You know, I mean, like, my experience was of not being parented very closely, which is how I was able to get away with all the shit that I got away with. And so, you know, to the extent that there's an ambivalence there, I think, you know, it's because he was not around that often. And even when he was there, I kind of felt like he wasn't there. And, you know, that's something that I absolutely know that, like, he did the best he could with, you know, the resources available to him emotionally. But I think, as all, you know, young people moving into adulthood, like, it's something that I continue to, you know, struggle with resolving and try to work on. I also have said many times, and this is not to give my, like, let my parents off the hook completely, but, you know, like, I came out when I was so young, and I think, you know, like I said to somebody the other day, like, I literally came out in the 90s. Like, I'm 27 and I came out in the 90s. I think, like, because I was sort of on, because I'd already self-identified as being sort of different, my parents took a sort of, like, they didn't exactly know what to do, and they were super supportive and very progressive, but they kind of just, like, let me do my own thing, and were sort of like, okay, he's gonna figure this out, which is how I think a lot of this happened, is because they gave me so much latitude, because they wanted to be sort of permissive, and they understood that I was different, and they wanted to let me be different and self-express. I don't think they wanted me to self-express in this way, but I think that's part of it.
That's interesting, because you know, it is striking that you come out so young, and I feel if this book had been written by someone a generation older than you, that would have been a key part of it. Like, this would have been a reaction to being gay, being closeted, being repressed and suppressed. But that really doesn't figure in your story. It's like, it's you come out, you're done with it, you don't, you know, you don't, being gay is not is not an explanation for your behavior.
Yeah.
It's just a, it's just there. That feels very novel, actually. Like that doesn't come up there. You don't present it as an explanation for your behavior. At the same time, a big part of this too is this idea of daddy issues.
Yes.
Your relationships with older men, your relationship with your own father. I'm just curious whether the daddy issue was how real that is for you. I mean, is that something that has been resolved post writing the book, or because again, it's left sort of hanging. That's just a part of who you are. But
yeah, no. I think it has been resolved. Actually, I've been dating people my own age for the first time in my life. How about that? Thank you for the applause in the back. That's wonderful. Appreciate that. So, I mean, it's something that I used to sort of joke about, but that was also very, very true for me. I mean, to go back to the first thing you said, I guess, I think that I'm really, really excited to be of the first generation that got to come out and have that not be the kind of defining part of the story, you know, to not have the coming out narrative be the most salient thing about the experience of like being gay, which I think for such a long time was the case. And because of the way, you know, the tides have turned culturally and politically, like now you can come out and come out into like a receptive, supportive, permissive environment, like the one that in many ways I came out to. I mean, it's better now for sure, but like, you know, I was of the first generation that got to have that experience and have it not be this super, super arduous thing. So I hope that we'll start to see lots more really, really interesting stories from people about what it is like to be young and gay and have it not be about wrestling with the fact that you are gay, but actually get to talk about like what happens after, because the what happens after is really, really interesting. And I think for better or for worse, you know, intimacy can be different for gay men, especially young gay men. And when you're kind of navigating your sexuality, especially early on, you know, it's complicated and there's no user's manual. Straight people get a user manual, right? Yeah, yeah, great. So I think that like, I'm really looking forward to seeing what other kinds of stories people start to tell that are not so dominated by the coming out thing. What was the second part of your question? I've lost it. Oh, daddy issues.
Daddy.
Great. My favorite topic. Like I said, it's something I used to kind of joke about. I've taken to dating age peers. It's true. But I think, you know, I said this earlier today and I was like, ooh, is that like controversial? Did I just totally put my foot in their mouth? But I'm gonna say it again and just like cross my fingers and hope for the best, which is like, I think gay men have different relationship with their fathers than straight men do. Like, I think that's just like a fact. It was definitely true for me with my brother who's straight. And I think that as you are, you know, trying to figure out like what you are attracted to and what you look for in a partner and what you're drawn to and what you respond to emotionally, sexually, whatever, like the fact that you are attracted to somebody of the same sex plays into that, and your model is your father. So fundamentally, you're going to have like a different relationship with people of that gender, including your dad. You know, for me, I think it's pretty textbook that I was like looking for affection from dudes who were a lot older than me because my dad was like super checked out. I mean, that's like very 101. But, you know, in terms of like carrying that into my adult life, I guess I don't feel like, you know, it's definitely not something that like bothers me or plagues me. And actually I have like a, you know, a pretty solid relationship with my dad at this point that doesn't feel like tortured or obviously not Oedipal, but you know what I mean. Yeah, it's all good, basically. It's all totally good.
I think that's a perfect note to pass us over to the audience, actually. Can we have some questions? Anyone
literally
questions?
None. Literally no questions.
You answered them all.
Great. Hi.
Would you be able to read from later in the book?
Yeah, totally. I didn't plan to, so I really gotta think on my feet here. Do you guys want to hear about the time when these dudes pulled me out of bed in the middle of the night and took me to wilderness boot camp in Utah?
I think that's a great segue.
Yeah. Okay, great. Perfect. I'm just going to start there. Great. This is good because nobody had any questions, so now I get to fill some space. That's awesome. Cool. They appeared in the night as in a dream, two men shadowed in beams of charcoal half-light. They stood in the doorway of my bedroom, dark-skinned and hulking, impassive as sculpture. They didn't speak, but their presence was as rattling as a shot of adrenaline. I jolted awake. Perspiration stung on my brow. I licked my lips. My tongue felt useless, like it didn't belong in my mouth. As my eyes began to adjust, I looked stupidly at the men, and they looked back at me. It seemed like only minutes before that I'd stumbled out of a packed nightclub, cigarette smoke unfurling in the air, the taxicab sprawl, my doorman leering, the slickened walnut panels of the elevator spinning around me, a clumsy face first collapse into bed. I could still taste the evening's vodka tonics, feel the sticky hubris of lip gloss tingling on my cheekbone, that telltale clenching in my jaw from the two tabs of ecstasy that I'd taken shortly before midnight with my friend Sahara. She was just a few blocks away, across the park. I should call her, I thought. I wonder if she's tripping out, too. One of the men snapped his fingers, jerking me into alertness. I had dozed off. I looked at them, trying to will them into nothingness. Then I glanced at the clock. It was 4:30. I moaned. The men were still standing there. I was awake suddenly, acutely awake. You should pack a bag, one of the men finally said. His face was inscrutable. Was I being kidnapped? A frisson of anticipation scaled my spine. Kidnapped. It was so glamorous. Where are you taking me? I asked. Who are you? Where's my father? My father. I sat up in bed and I could see his silhouette in the hallway. He was quaking, his face buried in his hands. Daddy, I said. He disappeared into the dusky light of the corridor and I focused back on the two men. Where are you taking me? I repeated. Rehab, the other man said. Rehab? I said. My voice cracked. Oh no, this is a mistake. It's not, he said. Where? Aspen, one of them said. Aspen, I said. Oh, great. I let my imagination project me into a ski lodge. I would be nestled in an overstuffed armchair before a fire, its flame crackling. I would be sipping from a mug of peppermint cocoa, wearing a chunky knit argyle turtleneck and suede snow boots. I'd talk about my feelings and then maybe hit the slopes in a fur-trimmed parka and oversized sunglasses. Aspen would be okay. Get your things, one of them said, brandishing a tan canvas duffel at me. It had come from my father's closet, I knew. The realization that he'd planned this suddenly dawned on me. I lurched to my feet and tossed a few essentials into my bag. My laptop, a diaphanous cashmere sweater, facial moisturizer, a fistful of jewelry. The drugs left shimmering trails on my bare feet as I shuffled into a pair of leather bedroom slippers. It was so practical. I heard a gust of laughter. I looked up at one of the men. What are you packing? He said. I eyed him warily. You're going to the wilderness, he said. What? You said I was going to Aspen, I countered, arms akimbo. I studied the contents of my unzipped bag. I had been so pragmatic. Aspen, he said. Aspen is the name of the program. Wilderness rehab. In Utah. Panic prickled in my scalp, then corkscrewed down through my fingertips. My father materialized in the doorway. Sam, he said. Go with them. Shit, I said. Shit. Then with gusto, shit, shit, shit. I began to cry, momentarily deafened by a ringing in my ears. Feebly, I punched a pillow. Could I escape? As I straightened my back to my full height, tears gushing down my face, I realized that the men dwarfed me. I was 6 feet small. A ripple of muscle poked from the sleeve of one of them. He tensed. A getaway attempt was futile. You better not try and run, he said, working some eerie telepathy. I won't, I said. I meant it. He motioned me out of my room, and I limped forward into the kitchen. At the front door, my father put a hand on my shoulder, then pulled me into a hug. I allowed my arms to dangle limply at my sides for a moment. Then I pulled away. He would pay for this later. "Don't fucking touch me," I spat. His beard was wet with tears.
It's great. I
gotta be honest, when I read that section, I actually got up and made myself a cup of hot cocoa. I really did. I was like, I need a cup of hot cocoa.
Yeah, totally.
one of the things that did strike my mind very superficially is that you get to see a lot of America if you're going through rehab.
You really do. I did.
Like New Orleans, Boston, Tennessee. Mm-hmm.
It was
Utah.
All over the place. Yeah, all over America. World tour.
I mean, and please jump in if anyone has a question, but I'm gonna ask a few more. Oh, we have some now. Excellent. Okay. Over here on the left.
Can you tell us that you did not bring your physical jewelry?
Oh, I did. Oh, I did. I absolutely did.
Clear.
Yeah. No, I did. I did. In the back.
I went to college with Sam, and he was just as charismatic and engaging as he is in the book. Like, it is like, it's not an act, it was so real. Second, like, I finished reading it like very soon after I finished reading A Little Life, and I think that like one thing that the author of A Little Life said, that she wanted to write a story about a character that doesn't get better. Mm. She really followed through with that, if anyone has read that book. And I think what I like loved about how you approach this is that there's so many points in the book where you think this is it. Like, I think, like, if anyone who hasn't read it, like, this rehab scene is like the first rehab scene, and it's so interesting to me that there's so many different points in which you like, all right, this is the rock bottom, like, this is going to be the end, this is going to be the turn.
Nope.
And I guess it's just like, in writing this book, like, did you like learn anything? Like, what was the final time versus the other time that like made it really stick? Because every single time you had like a new blank slate to sort of recreate, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the final time was just the worst. Like, there, you know, there's no other way to say it. And if you've read the book, I think you know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't, like, it's super gnarly. Like, shit got so dark. And I think, you know, I was thinking today about, you know, like all of these kind of episodes where people intervened and I got like shipped off somewhere, or, you know, successively like shipped myself off somewhere, as things got progressively worse and worse. And, you know, like all of that, there was like a cumulative effect to all of that, you know, like even when I would like come out and then end up going back to my old bad habits, like I still took something away from all of those experiences, I think. And I don't think I realized that at the time. I would just be like, God, here I am again, like back in the habs, like this is such a waste of time. And actually, like, there was a lot of, I learned so much from each of those experiences. And so I feel like when it all kind of finally crystallized for me and I turned things around and, like, got my shit together, it was really, you know, it was like all of that buildup all finally sort of coming together for me in a way where I could make it useful.
Was there a moment where you realized, oh, I don't know.
All right. Oh, everyone's good. Oh, okay. Was there a moment where you were like, I have to write this, I have to tell my story? And also in writing this, was there like a sense of closure or endness that came with this? Or is this like for you, like a step into the next, like obviously there's, you're not dying. You got the next few, like, 100 chapters of your life, but...
Hopefully.
Yes, but, yeah, I'm just wondering if it's, like, this was, like, for you, that closure, or, like, if you... What made you say, like, I, like, need to write this? Like, I need to get this out?
God, I don't know. I think, you know, like I said earlier, I really, really wanted to be interesting, and I wanted people to think that I was interesting. And so I think as I was going through all of this, I was thinking in the back of my head, like, oh, this is going to make such a good book someday. Like, this is crazy that this is happening to me. You know, because that's the kind of person that I was. And I actually think that, towards the end of my, you know, like my using and my acting out, like that had actually disappeared, and that was really scary for me, for it to not be about having like crazy experiences that like would make great fodder for the book I was going to write someday, but to actually just be a drug addict who was not writing anything or planning on writing anything was really, really scary, because suddenly my identity went from like, you know, the sort of like messy crazy kid who was like living on the edge to just like being a straight up addict with nothing else going on, like not a lot going on at the moment. And I think, you know, once I cleaned up my act, it didn't take very long for me to kind of like come back to this material and be like, oh, there's a story here, you know. It took longer for me to actually write it and to figure out, you know, like the shape and the kind of story that I was going to tell. Because the weird thing about a memoir is like, you have this like this raw material of life experience to draw from, and you're just sort of like shaving it down to, because the only parameters are like that it happened, that you lived it, but it's a process of relief, you know, like you are removing the things that don't serve the story. So it took me a really long time to figure out what that story was and which parts I should take out, and the stuff that's left in the book, you know, there's plenty of other things that happened. Like there were nights when I actually just did my homework, believe it or not. I swear. Those are not in the book because those didn't serve the story that I was trying to tell. You know, like you edit stuff down and you remove it. So yeah, I'm just fully rambling. Did I answer your question? Okay, great. Sure, good.
I'm back here too.
Hey. Absolutely not. I feel really, really fortunate to have the job that I have and to have the life that I have and to do super cool stuff, like hang out with celebrities and write about it. That's really, really fun, and I'm really, really lucky that I get to do that for my job. But you know, it's not part of some like some bigger overarching narrative that like 10 years from now I'm gonna look back on and like write the harrowing, revealing memoir of like my days in the trenches of industry parties or something. You know, I mean, like there's really like it's
they can be harrowing though.
They're definitely not harrowing. The hors d'oeuvres are great. So yeah, I don't feel like my life is ruled by narrative in that way anymore, which is nice, actually. That hadn't occurred to me until just now, so thank you.
We have time for one more question. Do you want
to? Hi, Prince.
Hi.
So was there any moment when you were writing the book that you kind of like maybe just had like a moment for yourself where you're like, I can't write this. Like I'm like, I can't.
Oh yeah,
breaking
totally.
Down. All right. Cause like I figured like, oh, like I really figured like, oh, I got this. I could write all this.
No, not at all. At no point did I say I got this ever at all. There were a lot of moments where it was really, really hard. Writing a book is hard. People keep being like, I want to write a book. And I'm like, don't do that. What are you thinking? It's really, really hard work. And especially, I mean, of course, writing a memoir about some really, really painful stuff is a difficult thing. And there were plenty of moments where I was like, I cannot go on. But like, I'm writing a memoir, you know, like it's not like Doctors Without Borders. Like there are people doing much nobler things in the world who are probably, you know, like crossing the desert of Kyrgyzstan to give someone medical attention, and they're like, I can't go on. You know, I mean, like I was like sitting in a nice house, tapping away at my laptop with an iced coffee. You know, like it was not so bad, but it was hard and it was painful and it was emotional, and I'm really glad that it's over. And if I'm lucky enough to get to write a second book, then I just like eyed my editor in the back of the room very meaningfully. Then it's definitely going to be lighter than this one. That I know for sure.
Fantastic. Perfect. Thank you. I want to leave everyone with one parting image, which is of Sam, the guy who was going to take his David Yurman jewelry and his cashmere sweaters to Aspen, in Aspen, in Utah, a few weeks later, jumping up and down on a maggoty dead cow, trying to pull its bones to pieces.
You'll read the book. You'll love it. You'll love it. But it's great. It's great. Yeah.
It's a journey.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Aaron. Oh, thank you guys for being here.